Compute. Hi,
Looks like it to
everyone.
me. I see it.
Yeah, recording. Hi, everyone. It's Kasia from Tarot Map, and this is another episode in Inspired Tarot Map. And this time I have as a guest somebody amazing that I'm in love with right now so much. It's Angela Mary Magic. Hi, Angela.
Hi. Hello, Kasia. Hi, everyone. Hello.
If you follow me on Instagram, you will know who Angela Mary is. But just in case there is somebody who's lost, she's the creator of the Moon Baby Magic Tarot. And yeah, Angela, thanks. So that's the box. And that's this amazing, colorful, beautiful deck. And I received this deck for review from Angela because I fell in love with it and I wanted to do that. And now I have been playing with it for over a week because it was waiting for me in Croatia. And I got COVID in the meantime and I had to just like wait. And the deck was here and I wasn't here, but now I'm here. And to be honest, Angela, I have to tell you, first of all, thank you for sending it. Second of all, thank you for creating it. It is, for somebody who has been reading tarot for a very long time, and I've been in the tarot world for a very long time, and I have many, many decks because I review decks. This has been so much fun. The possibilities of interpretation, the elements that you added, like the moon phases, and we are going to be talking about it in a sec in depth, but I just wanted to just really pay my respects because as a creative person, I find this deck like unbelievably amazing to use. And I know I'm going to be exploring it and exploring it forever. It's amazing. So thank you
so much for that generous, you know, impressions that you're having. You know, tarot for me, it's about developing our tongue. It's dialect. And with dialect, that means accessibility too. So I created this little freak as a way of deconstructing tarot and creating accessibility and multi-portals and ways that we can express ourselves, yes, of course, and develop our tarot tongue, our dialect, but also ways that we can interact and kind of like a lovemaking with multi-lovers, multi-ways that we can create our magic in the world, not just this really oppressive, really detailed, almost like gatekeeper-esque quality to tarot, which I see developing more and more and more. I'm on the deconstructed end. And that's just very simply because I believe so much that everything is a spell, that the works that I'm creating create our world. And I believe that about everyone. So I don't want to weave a web that's so intricate people can't access the magic that I have to offer. And so Moon Baby Magic Tarot is about color magic, it's about lunar magic, and it's about simple keywords on every card so everybody can have that spark and find that access point that unlocks their own intuition. And so having a complex guidebook wasn't my path, but having a guidebook that's alive is my path. So it's a simple, small book that leads to a paperless resource. And I'm really happy and lucky to say that Oprah Magazine got a hold of Moon Baby Magic Tarot because it's sensuous. It's many things. It's for your eyes. It's for your hands. It's for your ears. So the deck itself is a playlist. So every card has a song that goes with the upright and the reverse. And I'm just thrilled to tell you that that's developing even more for the third and final print, which I'm crowdfunding right now on my own so I can create a sliding scale for Black, Indigenous, and people of color, which is everything to me. Access, once again, creating accessibility, and not pretending that isn't a huge issue. So I crowdfunded in 2020 on Kickstarter Moon Baby Magic Tarot. I did the second print on my own. And this third and final print, which I was very clear with from the beginning, this would be printed three times, is upon us. And I've developed something new right now that is a lover to Moon Baby Magic Tarot and all tarot decks that I'm doing on my own. So I'm continuing to develop my own unique tarot tongue throughout all of this, which is a challenge. I mean, it's not like it's the easiest path. I know that I could take Moon Baby Magic Tarot to the grave. I could crank and exhaust this little baby out into the world. I could have it at Urban Outfitters. I know these things. I just knew that wasn't for me at my age and stage in life. I had to be clear about exactly what I have to offer. So it's kind of a lot, but the package itself is very accessible. And Kasha, I feel like we have that together, like circling each other when we first met, like where are we at with our own individual work and how can you and I dovetail together and tell our own story, but also enjoy our relationship at the same time. Yeah, I just think that there's plenty of consumerism in magic. Plenty of consumerism in tarot. And for me, this is more about artistry, accessibility, and creating foundational work that really speaks to my ethos and my values. So longest introduction ever to say hi. I'm in California, the unceded territory of the living Tongva people, and giving all the fucks.
Oh, you know what? That was awesome. And actually, you have such beautiful voice. I remember in one of your videos, in only one of your lives, that you said that your kids said that you have a voice that would be great for ASMR videos, which I so had to laugh when I heard it, because I was like, yeah, bloody hell, that's so true. So yeah, you, I don't know, your way of talking, it's beautiful. But I actually wanted to read something from that little booklet to Moon Baby Magic Tarot, that you write that you, creating my take on tarot meant that Moon Baby Magic Tarot would have to look, sound, feel, and be my living values. That means this project is non-culturally appropriative, inclusive to all beings, with an array of non-binary handprints, plants, animals, and stones. And I thought that's like so beautiful, simple, stated, and important these days, especially where we all kind of working towards, I mean, most of us towards more inclusivity, more equality. And you know, I was actually recently thinking of something when I was traveling to Croatia from Poland. And you know, I'm not comparing myself to any minority culture or, you know, black people in America or so on, because I know it's not the same, because I still have my white privilege. But in Europe, we belonged to the poor countries, right? We were the third world countries of Europe. And I think that economic equality brings so much, like, you know, now we're traveling and it doesn't matter if I'm next to German person, to Austrian person, to I have a similar car and I have a similar ability to buy similar stuff and I don't feel worse, not just because of money, but it comes with so much more. But money is that bridge that kind of equalizes you. So I think what you're doing with Moon Baby Magic Tarot, it's really important to offer it to people also who are in the worst position, not because they not smart enough, not because they can't do better, but because the system is so fucking oppressive and wrong that even if you work hard, like what could I have done in communism? I could like shit myself and I wouldn't be having like businesses and stuff, you know? So I kind of really appreciate that you're doing it and that you actually didn't want to use Kickstarter because you couldn't offer sliding scale and that you're doing it through your private website. And I'm totally like want to support you with that. And I think...
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm just... because it's recording now, my friend mentioned, and I think that's a great idea because maybe more people would like to do that, that you add a donation kind of button to your
website. I wrote that down. Thank you, Kasia. Yeah, I'll definitely create a donation button, which is like one of the big things on Kickstarter. That's that base level where you can just, you know, send a coffee, help out yeah. with the project because you believe in the essence of the project. Yeah. And so, yeah, so I've got like a tip jar, but now I realize I need to just have a more clear donation button for this project.
Yeah.
Because the more we travel in this project, the lower the sliding scale goes. It's for a deeper purpose.
Exactly. And many people have
singled out. It's a slower start than Kickstarter because I don't have that big bulky machine pushing it out into the world. And I've found that, speaking of tarot tongues, I've been so keenly aware to not tokenize Black, Indigenous, and people of color in this work. So it's slower for me putting it out into the world. And I'm so incredibly grateful for my worldwide coven, mostly operating on YouTube and on Instagram as well, for just believing in this work, sight unseen, especially with the uniqueness to the lover deck that's developing with Moon Baby Magic Tarot in this new project that I'm calling Altalune, which is a sensuality oracle deck. I certainly don't take the easy path, but as a, you know, multi-decade reader, the themes of love and abundance are incredible. They're constant. We want to love and be loved. And the way that we interact with our own love affairs is through our body. Witchcraft is embodiment. I'm a witch. I'm a 55-year-old witch. And the body is how we relate to everything in the world. So the new Altalune sensuality oracle cards are lovers to all tarot decks, especially Moon Baby Magic Tarot. And each card is dedicated to a tarot major arcana and court card. And then there's a dozen rewilding cards. So it's 50 oracle cards that can go with any tarot deck to enliven and bring that work into the sensualness of your life. That's everything you hear, taste, touch, feel. So yeah, it's a little bit of a sex magic deck, I'll be honest with you. Yeah. And so Amanda from Indie Deck Review, whom I adore, calls Moon Baby Magic Tarot like a teenager with a switchblade. It's strong. You know, even though it's cute, it's strong. It's like, you know, something might break in the room, you know, when you're around teenagers. Altalune is the next place. It's a little bit more getting into like when you're feeling yourself a little bit older, a little bit wiser, and knowing that you have that confidence, you love your swiveling hips, and you're ready to bring your magic into your body, into your sensual practices. So yeah, I'm not doing the easy path with anything. And I find that like foundational. I think that I can't ignore the things that I see now. I just can't ignore it and go for the easy grabs and the low-hanging fruit. I just can't. Yeah. My goal is to remain independent and very much in my witchcraft of it, not appealing to the masses saying this is witchy. I want to keep that strength in my expression.
Yeah. So can I, I had a plan for this interview, but it's all fucking going.
No shit. I'm sorry.
No, it's going way. I'm happy with this. We just flow. It's fine. But I usually ask my guests about their ancestry because I know that also on sure. Altalune Oracle, you yeah. are using the Shilana Geek. So a spoiler yeah. now, but
yeah, it's okay.
Can you tell us about your ancestry and show us maybe one of the cards so people
sure.
can.
Yeah, so Altalune itself, now with Moon Baby Magic Tarot, one really big foundational piece is that it is also a flip book. And for anybody that hasn't seen it, may I show you?
Yes, please.
The phases of the moon move through the deck nearly 10 times. It's an 80 card system where it's got the lunar and the color magic on cards 79 and 80 with their own keywords. So when you pull a card like the Fool begins on the new moon, of course, because that's where the journey of tarot begins with the Fool. So we have to begin at that core, that beginning of the lunation, which is the new moon. And there's a key word for that that's called initiation, right? So when you pull a card that's got a new moon on it, you have that way to read into that too and to share that with your clients. And then there's color magic right here that talks about keywords for all the different colors from the cards because it's a double rainbow, right? So Altaloon picks up that theme. And it also tells the story on the front and the back. That's a flip chart. So this is the backs of Altaloon in the ultra, ultra prototype stage, because when we reach a specific, goal, just like Kickstarter, Altaloon will be holographic foil. And Altaloon is this serpent running and kind of through the garden of life. And Altaloon circles the moon. So it's a flip chart on the back of the cards and all 50 cards. And then the front of the cards, Altaloon moves over the moon right here. So the moon really is specifically about our sensuous nature and our sexual nature. Sheila Nagig is the wild goddess who's been stolen from us, that lives in the British Isles, specifically like Ireland. And I come from an Irish Catholic Celtic background that I continue to learn and unlearn and move through the joy and the pain of what that was to be a witch born into a Catholic family. And Sheila Nagig sits with her arms and legs spread, holding open her vulva as a way of offering life to the world and protection to the world. So this is the Sheila shape. And you see these like four notches on each side that speak to the eight phases of the moon, and also Sheila's fingers holding open the vulva. And there's keywords, sex positive keywords in the vulva, in Sheila. We'll see if my audience can handle this. So far, so good. And then the moon phases change as well, looking like sexual organs at the top of Sheila. And then Altaloon moves around the moon, and that will be foil stamps again. And then Sheila will be gold leaf foil stamp on the faces of the cards, right? So again, that's back into this color magic field, which I'm taking to the next level. I don't know anybody that's doing this work. There's some fun, cute sex magic products out there, but this is for folks that are grown and mature and relating to their body and bringing that magic through their tarot experience. And a lot of it's for tarot professionals that are offering this work to folks, because I help folks with what they're going through with their bodies changing magic, their devoted loves changing magic, their polyamorous magic, their queer magic. You know, there's just so many ways that sex is shamed. And so I'm working with people enhancing the pleasure of their experience in ways where they can release the shame. But I got to do it through my lineage. So Sheila Nagig is so here for me. And I'm learning through her and about her, especially how mysterious she is and how she's been stolen from us. She's still very mysterious about why she lives above some churches in Ireland and England. And right. So many of them are literally defaced and physically stolen, and the story itself is stolen. So I had to move towards it. I had to move towards that mystery.
Yeah.
Again, not making it easy.
Oh, sorry, Angela. I say the last one, the last sentence again, because I.
That's okay. I'm just remarking on how I don't make it very easy for myself, and I think some of that has to do with my age. Some of it has to do with feeling like, if I don't move towards these things, like creating this sliding scale for Black, Indigenous, and people of color, and if I don't utilize my magic for as much healing and awareness as possible, what good is it?
Yeah.
You know. I'm a working class person. I'm in a relationship with a working class person. We raised two kids together, our kids. And it's always so dicey, survival. I'm not a trust fund person just hanging back going, that would be cute to talk about sex now. No, I'm like, it's vitally important that we bring our sensuous nature, our sensuality into our magic, because there's so much healing to do. So much.
Yeah, I totally agree. And actually, I love that saying. You already said it once in the interview that everything is a spell.
It's
And
so
could you
true.
just like expand a little bit on it? Like how did you come up with it? And like, what do you mean? Like for people maybe who are like what do you mean everything is a spell, Angela? I love that.
Well, it came up in a reading with someone many, many, many years ago because they felt so out of control in every way in their life. They were going through a radical, radical expansion, and it was causing a lot of destruction in their life. They were moving past an old life and into a new life and wondering, like, why is this happening? And how can I make all of this destruction stop? And whether we're experiencing or expressing what our intentionality is with everything, every bit of it is woven into our grand shared web of life. All of it is. And so, truly, what I am expressing, what I am feeling, even if I'm not saying it out loud, it's still creating shapes in the world. That's all I can do is reveal how I feel. My Venusian heart message, it moves through my heart and into my hands, and I make those shapes in the world. So everything that I am is becoming in the world, whether I'm naming and claiming it or not. So it's the utter simplicity that I need in my own life right now, as I see systems of oppression literally crumbling like towers everywhere around because they're unsustainable. I see the need for us to really simplify so we can survive these times and really keep our skin in the game. You know, everything we do is a spell that's becoming. It's all dreams, it's all intentionality. Whether we own it or not. So, might as well take a look at it and see what we can do with this. So, we don't feel like there's no way that we'll die with those towers that are crumbling around us, right? I mean, there's just so much seriousness. There's no safe place anymore where you can avoid how intensely serious life is. And yet, in my practice with these products, I'm just going to be crass and tell you this is how I sustain myself, right? There's such an incredible need for pleasure because the brain develops, the nervous system develops. Without pleasure, there's lack of development there and there's more suffering, and we develop all the hormones like cortisol and adrenaline that actually harm our nervous system and our health and wellness. We have to find our pleasure inside of this. So I need to sort of like keep myself aware that we're rewilding the garden of the world, the sensuous nature of our bodies, and creating that more space in the world for us to create sustainable magic, ethical magic. As these towers fall.
Beautifully said. So if we speak about tarot in general, when did you start with tarot? Like how did you start with tarot and why tarot?
Yeah, no kidding. Especially because I would tell you I was fascinated, but I definitely felt like I didn't have the chops or the intellect or the accessibility or the cash for it. So it was way back in the 80s, very early 80s. I think it was 1983. Two or three, I got a job in a bookstore in my local mall in the hometown where I still live. I still live in the same place in Orange County, California. I got the job specifically to earn exactly the amount of money that it took for me to go to cosmetology school. I'm a licensed hairdresser. And I encountered my first tarot deck there, and it was not in keeping, in alignment with me earning that exact $1,000 to go to cosmetology school. So on my breaks, I started transcribing the tarot in a little notebook, like my notebook that is the tiny guidebook, unique guidebook for Moon Baby Magic Tarot. And I had to write keywords that were a secret to me because I didn't feel like I understood tarot, because the intricacy of the images, it was the Rider-Waite-Smith deck. And I felt like it was off limits to me, that it was intellectually superior to me. And so I was thinking in my own sweet baby witch way that I was dumbing it down for myself. And I've had to work through a lot of those shames in life. And now here I am with two teenagers of my own. I'm aching and yearning to share the way we can deconstruct and simplify things that are kind of intricate to keep us away. Like, we can't taste the fruit behind the intricacy. Now I'm here to say, no, the fruit's for everyone. We're all gardeners. We can all taste the fruits. So that started way back in the early 80s, and I put it down, and somewhere, I haven't been able to find it either, my little transcribed tarot from the 80s. I felt a little bit more passionate about astrology, to be honest. I felt like that was more accessible because I could see the night sky. And so years later, as a salon owner, because I owned a salon for 13 magical years that I started when I was 20, everything I do is just so like scrape your knuckles, entrepreneurial and working class. That was also because of accessibility, because the salons I was working on, I worked on Rodeo Drive in Beverly Hills at a very fancy salon. It was like the toast of the town salon in those times. And it was all about making people have this impression that you had to have the blessing. It was almost like the hairdresser that I assisted, that I worked for, that was a creative director, didn't want to hear what people wanted. It was about them being quiet and him bestowing this magic that only he had on one person at a time. So I learned a lot about looking very excluding. And I knew that I just couldn't do that anymore. I couldn't. So I created a salon with my little rotary phone and my mixtapes. I still love playlists. I always have. And a feeling that I wanted to hear from people. So I always started all the works that I created with people with a shoulder, neck, and scalp massage, because hairdressers have a license to touch people. And when you touch people and relax people, there is an exchange, and there's this relaxation and comfortability that comes through, and then people can find a way to speak and express themselves. I was always trying to let people in and bring out, you know, this safer space for them to reveal how they feel. So yeah, laying hands led really naturally with all those, you know, pretty woman 80s perms that I was doing, double piggyback perms. Come on, for the hairdressers in the audience. Ways that people could, you know, sit around waiting for their, you know, perms to develop. We would always have oracle cards, that we started with oracle cards and then moved into a little bit of tarot, but those were pretty intricate. So then people just started tipping me to pull cards for them while their perms and colors were being processed. And when one of my staff members purchased my salon from me, I had this grand reset in my life, and my works, my witchcraft works, had developed to a place where that's all I wanted to do. This is before I had kids, is just hang out with witches and make witchcraft and roll around naked in my garden and just, you know, find my way back to myself after a really rough and tumble 20s of working in my own salon system, trying to work through all those, you know, really super harmful 80s hairdressing spaces. It was intense. And, you know, AIDS came and ripped through our culture, and so many guys died. And so we had a lot of trauma that we held each other in. And once that began to stabilize a little bit in the later 90s, in the year 2000, I sold my salon. I just kind of had all these chops now for surviving and nurturing and caring for folks that have been through lots of traumas together. And I don't know, it just naturally became tarot as an access point to talking about you know, different themes and intuitions and healing that people wanted to, you know, these are little portals and doorways that start conversations. They're not the end point.
Yeah,
right?
Totally.
So accessibility is just my total and complete jam. I can't stand gatekeepers. I really mean it.
Would you still agree that these cards describe you? Like they, in the little booklet, in the, who wrote the introduction?
Maritza K. Rubio.
Yes, Maritza K. Rubio.
Incredible person.
She sees you as a magician, as an emprex, and lovers. Would you still kind of...
Oh my goodness. That's a lot to receive. I admire Maritza so much. They have been here for so many of us. They are the founder and director of the Macara Center for the Arts, which is also completely online now, that was starting before the pandemic. So that nooked in there perfectly. I would say yes, because I have so much more confidence having gone through two cycles of printing these cards and shipping them. You learn a lot. So all three of those cards are about embodiment and physical embodiment of magic. And nothing's more physical than figuring out shipping to Croatia. You know what I mean?
I remember you like Croatia. Oh, well, let me check if I can ship
first. First for me. I love it.
It arrived really quickly, actually. I thought I would pick for myself right now the Fool, the Hierophant. I just love Hierophant of all decks, and maybe right now the Sun.
Beautiful.
Not my favorite card, but this time I felt like, yeah, it's kind of, I feel in alignment with these ones now, so...
Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah, I ask everybody to utilize Maritza Rubio's gorgeous, you know, invitation to pull the three archetypes that are you right then. That's a great, easy, everyday spread too. And they don't consider themselves a tarot author. They are a published author. But honestly, that's a fun spread.
Yeah. That was the other set. I thought I could go with High Priestess just because of the work that I do. I love Judgment card. It's one of my favorite cards ever. And Temperance as a Sagittarian, kind of constantly working.
I know. Bless your heart. You have promoted my deck more than I've found a way to do that.
I love it, though.
You're amazing.
When I love something, I'm like unstoppable. About the, like, if I'm passionate about something or someone, or, you know, an art piece, or, and I'm totally, as I said, like, I've been in the tarot world for so long, you know, I get bored. Yes. And yeah. I mix decks, like, I'm famous in our community because I'm always mixing tarot with oracle and 700, you know, when I do readings, I do astrology, I do tarot, I do oracle decks, just mix it all together. And what you did in the Moon Baby Magic Tarot, it's amazing because you can do actually timing with the moon phases.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You can, the keywords, I usually hate keywords because, you know, I'm a professional tarot reader, right? We don't read with keywords.
Exactly. Right. We've got it all memorized. I know. Right.
So, I actually recently found a Bright Future tarot, another tarot deck, which arrived, and I was like, oh wow, why did you send me the deck with keywords? I don't really like keywords. And then I started using it while this lady was sending me another deck without the keywords.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, I fucking love her keywords. Her keywords are great. And your keywords are amazing. It's really hard to do the keywords. Like, you did amazing.
That was a very, very long-term spell. I'd been creating Moon Baby Magic Tarot for years, and COVID hit and circumstances arose that made me have to continue, again, with the embodiment, put the skin in the game in my own life, in my own way that I was facing, you know, financial challenges within my little family and my need to continue to share what I believe in, which is, you know, working within local structures. Every single thing in this deck is created in it within a drive away for me, where I could physically go collect it. And that felt right for that time in 2020. But the keywords themselves, I think, are really important for this time, for our modern life right now, you know? And so they're challenging. Some of them are challenging words, and it's okay to feel challenged by a word like diversity. With the, you know, emotional intelligence is the key word for the Hierophant, which I find really important to keep developing, because there's just so many gatekeepers, especially with intellectual superiority, with who went to whose class, with who's got what degree, with who's the gatekeeper within our own community. The thing about life is emotional intellect. It's like you can really do anything if you keep developing your abilities emotionally. Yeah. So they're different keywords, that is for sure. One of the keywords is concatenate, and that's the only one that people have to look up. It's just one of my favorite words that speaks to how we braid together energies, because that's what's happening always in tarot readings. For yourself, you're working with your guardians and guides, your intuition, your inner child. But a professional tarot reader, which I feel like that's a huge thing in your spaces, is professional tarot readers, Kasia. Am I wrong? I feel like most of your followers are people that aren't just tarot lovers, they're tarot pros.
There's a lot of people who read for others, but also a lot of people who read for years, but they use it for themselves, but they know tarot really well. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, having those keywords that you can kind of have this exchange with other people is important. Like my Seven of Caves, the keyword is ripen.
Yeah.
Which can mean, you know, maybe you enter, and there's a new moon on that card, and the color field is blue. So the new moon is talking about initiating new ideas, and the blue field is ancestral magic and speaking your truth. And when we're talking about sevens, that's when we're talking about not pausing, but allowing the fruit to become sun sweetened, right? Because yeah, it's still got nutrition, but maybe it's not going to be the nicest thing to consume. So I don't know. I just love having the ability to tell people it's okay that this is a new phase of working through the final phase of a project. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like that third trimester vibe.
I actually have my few favorite keywords. Like, I love that you didn't shy away from using the quotation marks negative words, because I think very often that bypassing of hard, like stronger, you know, emotions that are not so pleasurable, it's like, it's just not true, right? We all have them.
It's not true.
And those five, exactly. That have, like, Five of Blades for trauma, which is such an important thing, because even, you know, even in our anti-racism work,
yes,
like, it plays such a huge thing, or grief for Five of Ways. I love that. Or when you go and use all these amazing, like, I think that's what, like, I was so fascinated when I started seeing all these goddesses, you know, and for me, Mary is totally connected to all of them. So when you were like, I'm just seeing this lineage also developing in your deck, I was like, oh yes, fucking yes, please, now. I want it now. So, you know, Venus of Willendorf, you have the snake goddess, you have Mary, you have the other Venus, which is really old as well.
So, yeah, in the caves of France.
And just that, the Hierophant for emotional intelligence, amazing keyword. You don't see this, or for even Queen of Caves, this mother, it's just so beautiful.
I really
appreciate, because first of all, you have to know tarot really well to do good keywords. Second of all, you have to be really in tune with the body intelligence and just have like this creative mind not to limit a archetype when you choose a keyword. It's so easy to limit it, you know, like that's why I think
it's true.
Those list of keywords, like, you can't just pick one because they don't hold it. But I think you did a great job with this. And
thank you.
I'm so fucking excited about those keywords. The Seven of Blades, bypass.
I would say to anyone creating a tarot deck, you got to be willing to be canceled for it. You have to speak so truly to who you are, even if it's an ultra simple message, because you see decks out there that are like literally look like it was 2 minutes with a Sharpie. But yet they tapped into something because they told their truth. And so this is my truth, and I was willing to be canceled for it. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
The same as when I was 20 years old, starting my hair salon with my rotary phone and my mixtapes. You know, I really knew that not everybody wanted to be in those environments being told how to look. In this way that there's just so many invitations in my deck. And yet, honestly, knowing now that it, you know, like Oprah Magazine and having the ability to do this third print run, which I had no idea when that would be. And I'm doing it inside of the same calendar year that I created it is it's pretty mind blowing. And so, and yet I really meant it when I said it, my guidance in this from beyond the veils was that I would be creating it three times. And I'm sticking with that. This is my legacy. This is my art. And this is my children's gift. So they can do with it what they want to when I'm gone, when I return to the earth, when my bones are resting, they can take what I'm creating now and do with it what they will. But when you create something, I have to be really clear, you know, it says it on Instagram, you got to call yourself something. I'm an artist. This is my artwork. And this was a solution to not being able to work with me one-on-one because it was just crushing for me to constantly be working one-on-one with tarot work. And then it was becoming inaccessible because the price had to be so high in order for me not to be booked 9 months in advance, right? So I just thought to myself, how am I not having this thing where I'm only working with privileged people. So the deck became a way that I could work with people that was like a quarter of the cost of booking a one-on-one session that went away, right? But it had to be in the magic of my own ethos. So it had to be printed locally. It had to be materials that were local and more earth loving and earth friendly. So literally I drove to collect the boxes. The person that creates the labels for all of my work is here in the Huntington Beach where I live. That's just what was right for me, especially in the time of COVID. So I'm learning new things to apply, but I knew I would learn all of those with Moon Baby Magic Tarot. And I'm sticking with that three printings and that's it. It's yeah. developing into something else that's coming where I can speak to the mysteries of how I created these and how one can work with them deeper in a little bit more of a workbook style. But I don't see that happening until 2022.
Yeah, but that would be cool. That's a great idea. Maybe you could do some, you know, workshops. Now everything is online anyway. So for example, person from Poland could join in, you know, and I wouldn't have to be in the US to join. That would be lovely.
Exactly.
So I think that's awesome. And for everybody who knows me, you know, guys, that I'm always honest about what I love and I only show decks that I love. But this is something that, as I mentioned, I have been enjoying so much because it has so many possibilities. So not only you can like play with your intuition when it comes to the little, you know, symbols that you put on. There is the moon phases. There is the regular tarot name. So if you know tarot, you also sort it. It doesn't mm-hmm. remind me of any tarot deck that I've had. It has color magic that you can, you know, use either with the little pamphlet, I mean, the card that you and Angela provide, but also, you know, all of us have some associations with the colors mm-hmm. nevertheless. So like developing mm-hmm. your own, it's really amazing because some of the colors I found they kind of in between the, mm-hmm. the
exactly
the that you use. So you kind of can play also with this, like, oh, it's a bit between the yellow and the green or between mm-hmm. purple and the pink. So that's really awesome. And yeah, I just find that
astrologers are going mad for Moon Baby Magic Tarot as a way to have an access point in conversation with their clients too, because there's these color associations with all the planets. And so it's just, I don't know. I didn't know what was going to happen, especially because I felt like I had to rename the suits to be a reflection of what was happening in my worldwide coven. We had been working through the study of caves when COVID hit. And so we were already in that space of talking about the body as the cave where we find our rest, where we do our healing, where we can hide. And so pentacles are caves. And then swords are blades, and wands are lasers, which is a little weirdo thing, but it felt like it had to be in that ancient future vibe of lasers, more useful, more modern. And then cups are waves, because I'm a beach witch. And it's kind of fun to say waves, caves, blades, and lasers. It's just fun.
It is. And it's actually it's easy. Sometimes, you know, when people change, like, I find it like doesn't, it's like somehow counterintuitive to my mind, you know, probably not to their mind because they made it. But right. Sometimes you kind of can't really quite get there, and it takes a while for you to actually remember like what the mm-hmm. suit is, what is what. But mm-hmm. for you, like the caves and the blades and the, you know, waves, like it's quite very yeah. easy to associate with the
exactly.
tarot. So I didn't have any issue. Like I just looked at it and I thought like, yeah, that's easy. Wave, water.
Yeah, cave, exactly.
Wave, it's you know, blade,
it's
sword.
Witchcraft. Yeah. It's calling in those four corners and witchcraft all the time. But the lasers thing, this is about cutting through bullshit. This is about cutting away, cutting cords, and moving into our future self experience of rewilding our earth via our body, via embodiment, because things have to change to create what I always refer to as my gargantuan spell, where we're weaving together our world where everyone is sheltered, fed, and has sovereignty. And there's complexity inside of that. But for me, in my just simple human experience, in my animal body, I have to reduce it down and compare it to that. Does this really feed, you know, the idea of like feeding many birds with a single grain? That's what I'm feeling like this is. So Moon Baby Magic Tarot is my spell. And same with Altaloon too. It's like, did I have to create a sensuality oracle deck? Did I have to make it hard for myself? No, I could have done it a lot easier. But I have to be honest with you. I really think that this has got legs that can move with time. When we're creating ways that we can return back to our body and find a way to let our bodies exist in pleasure, in sexual and sensuous pleasure, we can do it. I just think it's that important that we have the truth of needing and craving pleasure constantly in our bodies in order to have a life worth living. Yeah, you know, because all of that's been kind of taken from us too. This idea that there's only one season of your life where you have beauty, and there's only one time in your life where you can talk about orgasms, and it's only in that time where you're 18 to 24, you know, everything directed to the Cosmo reader. Do you know what I mean? No, we are magical. We're amazing. We're made to change sizes. We're made to age, and time marks us. It's supposed to, you know, and this is the embodiment of how time has marked me. Yeah. And Altaloon making a sex deck is the same thing. It's about talking about sex and sensuality from a really seasoned place. I believe in it. You know, did I need to draw attention to myself like that, having teenagers living in a very conservative suburban town that's been the epicenter of all bad things since the beginning of the pandemic? Well, maybe I'm making it a little bit harder for myself, but I have to look in the mirror. I have to see myself, you know, in every moment. And this is work I'm really proud of and excited about. And I'm so glad that you love it and you get it. It's like putting the queens at the top. I had to do it, you know? I noticed that you said online the other day that you thought it looked like Mary on my moon card. I just wanted to let you know that this is Saint Teresa.
Ah, is it Saint Teresa?
And that's a little bit different. Saint Teresa, there's a lot of studies now about Saint Teresa being
from Avila, or the one with the baby Jesus. Ah, no, that's the baby Jesus, Teresa the little flower.
Yeah, no, this is Saint Teresa was the, I think of her as a lover of Saint Francis of Assisi. She loved nature and magic and plants and animals big time. But St. Francis, as cool of a dude as he was, got all the credit. So I had to do it because this is our shadow self. This is the way that we are bypassed and discounted and in pain and developing, and the way our subconscious mind is constantly working through all of those ways that we are hurt, and that our pain is the access point for growth in many, many ways. So yeah, I really think that finding a way to create like a workbook that works through Moon Baby Magic Tarot. But first, honestly, in our world, it was all about, can I even fund this thing? Can I even survive? And I did not know how to use Kickstarter at all. So I barely limped across the finish line with a really honest budget. It wasn't one of those things. I see a lot of tricks that people are doing on Kickstarter now where they make their budget $5,000. So they fund in 2 hours and then they spark the algorithm over there on Kickstarter, which is a joke. And then they could say funded in 2 hours. You know, no, for my, you know, $15,000, almost $16,000, very honest budget, I funded with 20 hours to go. It was a massive effort, very draining. Yeah. So I'm trying.
Really hoping that this time it's going to, are you going to go to, you're not going to go to Kickstarter later on. No, you're just leaving, doing everything on the website because of the sliding scale.
Yeah, doing everything at www.angelamarymagic.com, magic with a CK. And yeah, the way that it's working now, I can do it with like $13,330. I got to get those angel numbers in there. And my ultimate goal is to get to $25,000 before May 20th. So I can start literally getting that sliding scale for Black Indigenous people of color down to zero, and I'm giving decks away at that point. So right now, the sliding scale for the $69, of course, it has to be fun, it has to be 69 for Alta Loon, is now $49 to $69 for Black, Indigenous, and people of color. So it's toggling down as the funds go up, but it's way, way slower. I did a Eager Beaver first week, and that's where I got lots of sales. And now it's slowed down, and I'm a little bit shy and not knowing how to communicate that without tokenizing folks of color. So it's very, I'm being honest about how challenging it is to do better in the way that I'm creating my own ancestral healing and I'm my own lineage of, you know, healing, because I am oppressed and an oppressor doubly as a light-skinned white person. As a woman, I'm oppressed and an oppressor. As a witch, I'm doubly oppressed because nobody wants to hear it from a witch till they slink to us by the cover of darkness when they need help. And they know we'll keep their magic secret. They'll keep, we'll be confidential for them. So it's, I'm trying to be honest and tell that story about how challenging it is to be a witch on their own. It is just me making all this work happen. A lot of people ask me if it's my teenagers that are doing my social media. It's totally not. They're fully on their own, you know?
Yeah. But you're very creative, you know, you're very creative. And just to like make it clear as well, like if you want to support Angela Marion, for example, you have the deck already and you, let's say, not interested in getting another one, there mm-hmm. will be this donation box when you can also just like send $10, $20, whatever lunch
Thank
money,
you.
Which would
Such
be
a great amazing. Idea.
And also, if you don't want to miss out on the deck, if you trust my judgment, because I don't know, you buy decks that I like and we have similar tastes, I love the deck, and you know me, I wouldn't be fucking lying to you just to make it something.
No.
Like, I really honestly love it. So it would be sad later on to see the deck being sold on eBay for $500 because it's not going to be printed anymore. It would be awesome to support Angela Mary right now, get it. And if you think that something along your line, I really, really highly recommend it. It's creative and it's fun and it's also really deep. So it's not that fluffy, you know. Rosie, oh, and then I pulled Three of Blades, Sapphire.
I know, exactly. I was like, I am so gonna get canceled or celebrated. There's gonna be no in between with this.
Yeah. And you know, yeah. Sometimes suffering, like, Like, it's so important. And I don't want to absolutely glorify, like, I don't want to glorify that you have to suffer to, you know, be happy. But, like, even looking at our, like, life experience, you know, how much do we learn? How much do we truly strengthen and blossom after that? Like, it's amazing. And it takes
it's
time
true.
And it takes work. But, yeah, I think...
Well, death is half of life. We have to have all of our... you know, life that we're living now, slough off and return to the earth. We have to. That's how the soil stays nourished to grow new seeds. It's part of this, you know, generative cycle, you know, it's the circle that just is constantly, that's why little Altaloon had to exist. I'm born in the year of the snake in 1965. So it was also partly that kind of magic, but you know, Altaloon is that, you know, Ouroboros, snake eating its tail, chasing its tail throughout the flip book of the front and the back of the deck. I'm having a lot of fun with it. But, you know, like Kickstarter, your faith in this work helps me develop it in the world. And I think that it's so right to talk about sensuality, embodiment, and sex.
Yeah.
You know, and expanding our ways to have pleasure.
Exactly. And, you know, very often in spiritual circles, like, there is such a division when it comes to this. And I think in general, like, obviously we can point back to religions, how they divided, you know, how Mary got robbed of all the sexuality.
Yes.
But then at the same time, you know, coming back to our bodies and bringing that focus on both. And I think there is shifting a little bit and actually including pleasure, that pleasure is spiritual, that sex is spiritual, that, like, not, there is no more disconnection between the bodily and the spiritual, because that's what we're bringing together. And I think that's what we are working towards also. And actually reshifting this focus, you know, of, like, white patriarchy and not being right all the time and constantly striving to fucking be better and prettier and, I don't know, more and more and more. Whereas I feel like with your work and with the decks and also with what's happening in, like, I call it top shelf spirituality, when you actually really embody and integrate shit as well, not only just, like, learn the next new thing, that we, you know, we integrating both the masculine, feminine, the like, we're really bringing back that spiritual and pleasure, the sex and the spirit. And it's really important to me. This is something that I'm really passionate about. And I think changing.
Yes, it's clear, Kasia, it's clear. You do such an amazing job with language, with finding the way to constantly communicate and celebrating people that you think are telling a unique story too. I love your platform. I love what you're doing. I don't get super nervous in the world, but I was, like, a little bit excited, nervous for you to encounter Moon Baby Magic Tarot, because it's so deconstructed, because it's so different. I didn't know what your impression was would be, but one thing I loved is I knew you would tell the truth. Yeah. I knew you would either just be like, I can't do it, Angela. I just can't, you know, it's too out there, too weird. I knew you would be honest with me about it. So that's what helped me to just give it up and relax and let it be, you know?
And, you know, obviously I didn't know how it's going to read, but
sure.
I love it. I love it. I didn't even know I would like it so much. It's just so much fun. It's really so much fun. And now doing those readings, like I did just a few readings for clients, you know, it's just
good.
Like, special, because I want to use it in real readings, like, not just for me, but, like, see how I can use it for people.
I'm excited.
And I have beautiful community around me and beautiful clients, so they always let me back. I'm like, you know, what else do you think? You know, is this moon phases? Let me know later on. Is it working? I say, you know, like, the time.
You got it.
So it's amazing. And I'm, like, wondering, I didn't get any feedback yet because I just started yesterday, you know, so
yes.
I'm, like, I'm just sending those readings out now, but that's a great idea for me to, you know, offer, like, really discounted readings, so that I know that this is something, like, a new deck I'm trying. That's shorter reading. I'm not going to go into, like, depth like I usually go with astrology and tarot and oracles and blah, blah, blah. But still, this is an awesome inspiration. Mm-hmm. If you need a little support, if you need something, you know, just food for thought. Like, I thought, like, this is just a cool way, like, you know, to, for me to practice and for a person to receive some insight. So... We'll see.
With the Kickstarter, I said that too. This is for tarot babies and professionals. I love supporting tarot professionals with everything that I do, with the spell work that I do, and especially with Moon Baby Magic Tarot, because we give so much. It's such an incredible exchange. We have so much on the line. So many of us are rejected by our blood family. So many of us are celebrated behind closed doors when the, you know, president of the PTA or the really conservative pastor's wife slinks to us by cover of darkness for their work that they need. And then by the light of day, they can't know us. Do you know what I'm saying? They have to reject us in a strange way. So this was about creating something, especially with the playlist, where you could give your client something. Hey, take this song and just listen to it for 4 minutes, center yourself and see how you feel. Do a little automatic writing and see how you feel in that hot pink color field that tells you to do some reconciliation, forgive yourself. There's just a lot of access points that are physical, because a lot of times people come to us when they're feeling out of control. And this is a way that they can start to wrap their arms around their inner child again, you know?
Yeah, you know, I thought I would add that songs to the reading in the background, but of course on YouTube now you can't do it because they will like just delete your video. But I thought it would be cool for the reading, you know, to have that like playing in the background. But that was also a lot of work, I thought, hey, to think like of a song for the for the straight position, for the reverse position, for all the cards. I'm like, wow, that's amazing how much like music knowledge you have to even like, I wouldn't come up with like, I would maybe come up with Major Arcana. That would be it.
I know what you mean. Well, music is just the reason why I started my salon when I was 20 years old. I did not need to make that hard for myself. There was the 80s was the first time that people were becoming like rich and famous hairdressers. The path was laying right there for me. I could have walked right into that path. Same with witchcraft and tarot. I've seen some big burnings go down in witchcraft in the years, you know, because I've been a lifelong witch, right? Mm-hmm. I've seen community crumble, almost like these bubbles that burst inside the community. I think we're due for another one pretty soon with with witchcraft, kind of witches calling each other out and these kinds of things, and people needing to learn and grow and see if they still want to claim the title witch, right? But I mean, we need that support as we move through things physical. That's why I was trying to really create that sensuality in the way that it looks and sounds. And with, I know there's not a lot back there in my unique guidebook paperless resource, but there's a section for witches brews. So there's a couple of witches brew recipes back there. So you can really sit down and taste the magic, take time with yourself and hold space for us creating a world where our magic and our life is sustainable.
Yeah, and you always, not always, but you sometimes when you put videos on YouTube, there was this Venus scent. I'm Venus scent. And
Venus sent me.
So, Venus sent you, yeah. I thought like that so also fits you because like you embody that sensuality. And I think, what does Alta Lune mean? Like, does it have, I mean, I know it's Lune, like with the moon, but like, does it have?
It has meaning.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Alta Lune is Greek and it means over the moon, because I've been trying to figure out a way to bring into language and physical form a conversation about sensuality and sexuality so we can, you know, celebrate our non-binary approach and our exploration. You know this, and I'll show the card to your sweethearts who are so amazing. I'm just loving the folks that have come over from your platform and are following me now. I'm having such a blast with everybody. They're so fabulous. My Knight of Blades keywords is explore kinks, right? So the knights are sexy in Moon Baby Magic Tarot. They're helpers. They're people that thunder in and want to help you nurture your sexuality and sensuality and find a safe way that you can have time and energy to explore what your kinks are, what you find a turn on, right? And so Alta Lune is that next place. Yeah, like I said, Alta Lune means over the moon. So I'm finding a way to kind of be further into my dance with lunar phases, with the magic of our night mind. That's the key words for my high priestess, the part of us that isn't so much about achieving, doing, having, communicating, pushing out in the world. This is more how we're receiving magic and integrating it into our body. So how we're relating to receiving sexual and sensual assistance from our guardians and guides, from our earthly lovers. So yeah, it's about kind of the dance around talking about even just celebrating our sexual organs and our bodies changing through time.
Yeah.
And this is the conversations I'm interested in.
Yeah, exactly. And that's another thing that I think, like you're 55, I'm 56, I'm 46. And
yay, 46 is amazing.
Right? I think it's important for, I don't want to say older women, but older than 30 and 20.
I'm older.
Actually show up and like, you
yes.
know, I think like we're beautiful that even like, so I'm in 40s, you're in 50s, women in 60s, when you actually pass your, you also pass your Chiron return and, you know, like you in this like wisdom sharing, wisdom giving space. When you don't have to bloody hell Botox. I mean, if you want to Botox yourself, go ahead and do it.
Yeah, totally. Do it all.
I mean, like, there is beauty to aging and there is beauty to, like, the wrinkles. There is beauty to
yes.
I think, like, I'm excited to see women like you, beautiful still, but natural, you know? And yes, we can use makeup, we can put our, you know,
sure. adornment.
Still this honesty about who you are. And yeah. I'm really grateful for that because you don't see much of it, you know? You don't see much of it. And I think this is going to be my also something that I'm aspiring to as I get older, to just keep being me, you know?
And showing up.
Oh,
ageism, I feel like, is just a bubble that is ripe to burst in our culture, in witchcraft, in our digital age of witchcraft. Mm-hmm. The ageism is just egregious and rampant. And so I will not go down quietly. I will not, you know, I have lived a life and I bear the scars of it. They're physical. They're real. I mean, I survived cancer in my later 20s. And so I've got scars on my neck from thyroid cancer. And you'll see in my magic, which I love visual magic. I love adornment. I always have. I always will. I believe in it as a way that we're communicating with our spirit, we're communicating with our works and people around us, with our circles. I adorn my neck a lot to almost celebrate and draw attention to the scars on my aging neck, which are funny because they make things buckle. I'm always casting a swallowing spell. That's why I love Witch's Brew. At the Witch's Confluence Spring Convergence this weekend at Beltane, I'm creating a spell and part of it has a Witch's Brew and we're bringing a mirror into it. We're watching our body physically move, our throat move. We're listening to the sounds of our body and watching as things, because I have scars on my neck that literally go into funny shapes and buckle as I swallow. And I'm here to celebrate that because I lived through that. I'm living with that. And there's no denying it. I'm not going to fucking wear a turtleneck in this gorgeous day in California. I'm going to adorn the reality of my, you know, thriving.
Yeah. And I love when you say it always. I love the sounds my body makes. I love it. And I think it's really beautiful. And there's one more thing about you before we finish off that I have to mention, because I think that's where I resonated with you a lot. It's that generosity of sharing, you know, like I you were like one of not many people, like I do it and I can honestly say I fucking share work of other readers, I advertise people who I believe in, I will advertise my friends who are tarot readers. I don't believe in competition like this, that, you know, like
yes,
we all fucking, there's enough for everybody.
That's so true.
Are totally like amazing at this, and I saw it, like, you know, I was so moved when you were like, you didn't even know me much and you were mentioning me and my channel and you mentioned other people and you saw,
oh,
me,
I love it,
and, like, just so beautiful, and I actually really, like, I'm very like moved by this, because it comes also from a very honest space. It doesn't come like you just doing it because, I don't know, you're searching, you're fishing for, you know, something else, like for somebody to pay it off or something. It's just like really
no.
normal. What I think it should be normal. It is normal. We live in this virtual world. There's like
yes.
6 billion fucking people in the world. Like,
I know.
So limit ourselves of not sharing. So yeah, I really appreciate it in you.
I feel like it's something that I can hear. It feels like harmonizing. It feels like to me that we're coming together in a vision, moving into a field, a fecund field, a really sensuous, beautiful field with a seed. And we're all gathering in a circle and we all make different sounds. And you can hear us gathering and coming into view and coming into the circle. And you know, when you're developing harmony with people, it ebbs and flows and moves on a wave, and sometimes it makes a funky sound, and then it starts to come into that convergence to that wonderful harmony. I feel like there's not just room for everybody, there's an aching need for everybody to be in that wonderful unison and show up in the circle. Not just one voice in the center that we're all worshiping, everybody together in the center worshiping that we are a circle, right? Everyone's together. And so, yeah, I love sound, and I love celebrating the sounds that everyone makes together. I've got a long way to go. I've just created my second newsletter ever. And so the main thing I'm trying to do is create a foundational strength in the works that I'm doing, because I've seen so many of my friends lose their Instagram pages because that's just ridiculous over there, or lose their YouTube channels. So I'm really strengthening the way that I have direct communication with other people. So I'm signing up for everybody's newsletter and I'm asking everybody to sign up for mine, because I can have a little bit of support in that now, because my bestie, who's my webmaster, just retired, and it's my full-blown intention to take up all of their time.
Well, you inspired me, because I've never done a newsletter yet. So.
Oh my gosh,
and
oh,
Tasha,
you are going to tear it up.
Yeah.
You were going to tear it up in that field. I mean, honestly, folks that I love working with have this incredible sustainable models. I love working with Sarah Faith Gottesdiener, who creates the Many Moons Lunar Planner every year. And I was really lucky that they paid me, like they pay all the contributors that make spells and enactments for the full moon and the planner. And they do everything else. They're an amazing artist. I got to be in their 2020 planner, which was a radical honor in my life. They do incredible with their newsletter. That's like, they have built their whole business surrounding how they can have direct communication with folks. And the Witches Confluence, which is called Modern Witches, they're amazing. And they actually create an amazing sliding scale for trans folks, queer folks, people of color. I mean, they're really, really doing some amazing things with their inclusion committee of folks of color, which is amazing over there. And I love Sea Grape Apothecary too. They also have ways that they can address people that have less means, having a different kind of ticketing structure, and people of color. So I'm here to amplify the works of folks that I'm learning from.
Yeah.
That is what I'm here to do.
Yeah. I have one always, like, we have to finish soon, because I'm like, I'm looking
at sure.
the time. But I'm just, whenever, you know, whenever I hear people of color, it doesn't sit right with me. Because I'm thinking, why does a fucking color too? You know what I mean? Like, I know it's, like, we're making a separation here because it's needed for this purpose, but I wish we invent some other like naming for it, because I think it's in this name, like people of color, I constantly feel like it's still the, you know, the annotation is to whiteness, right? That like suddenly white is not a color. Everybody is people of color, but not white people. We're not people of color. We like some, I don't know, what are we? We some kind of fucking other color that doesn't exist.
Yeah. And I definitely just... monstrous though. The color is colonization.
Yeah.
And the time is now to acknowledge that it is our ancestors that created that. Yeah. And I come from a long line of dirt poor working class folks. And I still fully own that whiteness created this harm and pain in the world. Yeah. And I can't unsee it, and I have to acknowledge it. And until that work is done, then we can move on. I love the incredible Leah Garza, who's Crystals of Altamira over on Instagram. And they have a podcast called We Are Power Crystals. I was really lucky that I got to be on their podcast. And they talk about, you know, this true love being the ultimate source of life. Right? The ultimate story that we're all working our way back to, but we can't bypass the incredible harm that exists everywhere. And, you know, I live in a place that just 2 weeks ago had a White Lives Matter rally in the town I live in, 1 mile from my home. It's unreal. Now they had their rally scheduled, and by the time they got there, there was like 500 of us, you know, supporting Black Lives Matter, which is the right thing to do. And so yeah. It's such an important time right now, but
you know, it's important. I just thought like, you know, that the naming is actually not fair to other colors, because it's still annotation to the white color as being the default, you know what I mean?
Like I know exactly.
So, like just the naming, I'm sure. Like maybe I'm hoping we can come up with something better than that. But I also I had something in my mind. Like when you were talking, I wanted to add something, but now it's escaped me. So I think we finish with just reminding people that your campaign it's open, or like how do we say it in English? It's open till. Yeah. 20th of May?
It is.
Yeah. So yeah. By 20th of May, 20th of May is the last day, right? That people can...
Yeah, that's the pre-order, pre-sale time.
And this is the last run of Moon Baby Magic.
This is it.
While you're alive, at least. Then maybe the children will reprint it, but while you're alive, that's the last run of the...
I'll let my kids deal with it later. They're both amazing intuitives and readers, but that's not the world they're living in now, because they're in high school and having fun with their friends and stuff. But we'll see if this doesn't bring them into their magic. That's not going to be anything I need to worry about. But honestly, I say this all the time in my spaces, that magic is your birthright and everything's a spell. This truly is my spell. Truly.
Oh. Okay, people, so please, I'm going to link everything clickable under the interview, you know, in the description box. So if anybody loves it, please go and get it.
Thank you, Kasia.
Everything is magic. And no, what did you say? Your magic is...
Everything is a spell. Magic is your birthright.
Everything is a spell. I love it. And
I love your spell, Kasia. Thank you so much for having me on. You're amazing.
Thank you so much. It was so wonderful to meet you, Angela. It's seriously a pleasure and honor to have you on Inspired Tarot Map, because I'm fucking inspired. And it's really lovely. Thank you for sharing your work and just for being honest and beautiful and Venusian, sent by Venus for sure. Thank you everyone for watching. I hope you enjoyed it, and if you feel like supporting this project, everything will be linked below, so let's do it. Let's create more beautiful, sensuous magic in the world. Why not? Thank you for watching, guys. I speak to you soon. Bye.